I was born and raised in Oakland County.
I really loved our community. My dad was a teacher in the Pontiac school system and my mother in the Rochester school system, so their connections and their support. And I think that I am a successful professional because of that, because of the support of the community. And that's what's exciting about the 40 Under 40, is that now you've met people that you can network with and say, well, this is what's going on in my neck of the woods, what's going on in yours? And that's a testament to L. Brooks Patterson of working really hard at giving a consistent quality of life in the community. Take Root was formed in 2013 with my partner, Thayer Jonitz, and I. We both were hired at Oakland University as dance professors at the same time. We started a nonprofit, professional modern dance company called Take Root. Our mantra is connection. How do we connect to the public that normally wouldn't connect with dance and movement? That's our goal. And so whether that's through K through 12 or Dance for Parkinson's, there's a lot of different outreach that we're doing. My parents' best friend was diagnosed with Parkinson's, and he and his wife went and took a Dance for PD class, and I've never seen him that excited. He called on the way home and said, you need to figure out how to do this, and I went out and got certified. Oakland University has been amazing with it, and free of charge, we can have the classes here, so we have one once a month. We started that a year ago in October. And ever since then, I have anywhere between 25 to 40 people show up. So Dance for Parkinson's is very personal for me. I feel that I'm giving back because I can, because I have the ability to do it. Oakland University is supporting it. We even have nursing students from the William Beaumont School of Medicine come into our classes as assistants. We're just getting lots of attention, which is wonderful because that gives attention to the Parkinson's issue, and that's the goal. You know, when I looked at the 40 Under 40 list for 2016, and it's a really broad spectrum, which that was exciting to see that. The spectrum goes into arts and into health and wellness, and that's really exciting because that should have as much attention. What I'm doing with Dance for Parkinson's and what Take Root is doing, it feels like that's what we should be doing. So it's exciting to be in this group of people because I'm pretty sure that all of the people that are in the top 40 feel the same way, that they're doing what they're doing because they love what they do and they're trying to make a difference. And if you get an award for it, then that's pretty cool. But you would do it anyway. My name is Allie Warner and I'm honored to be the 2016 Oakland County Elite 40 Under 40 winner.
Ralph Waldo Emerson reminds us, enthusiasm is one of the most powerful engines of success. I am humbled to be a member of this enthusiastic 2016 Oakland County Elite 40 Under 40 class, including my fellow finalists, Jeanette Brown and Nick Mraz. Oakland County residents are certainly familiar with L. Brooks Patterson's successes in sound government practices, fiscal responsibility, and economic development. Yet many of us are not as familiar with Brooks's enthusiastic and unwavering support of arts and culture. Brooks founded Arts Beats and Eats in 1997. This annual family-oriented event is now recognized as one of the top 20 most popular summertime festivals in the nation. In 2015, over 380,000 visitors attended Arts Beats and Eats, which raised more than $250,000 for local charities. Indeed, over $4.5 million raised by the Arts Beats and Eats Foundation has been donated to charity. Brooks began the Michigan Great Artists Competition in 2012 to promote artists and encourage creativity among its residents in Southeast Michigan. Brooks embraced and enhanced the partnership with Michigan Council for the Arts and Cultural Affairs, which awarded grants to Oakland County nonprofits for high-quality, locally developed projects. These funds not only increased public access to arts, they provided Oakland County creatives with vital professional and organizational development opportunities. L. Brooks Patterson said, everyone deserves to reach their fullest potential. Through his contagious enthusiasm, he gives Oakland County the ability to become their best selves and to follow his lead by paying it forward. I answered that call as a born and raised resident of Oakland County and found my own unique way to give back. I developed the Dance for Parkinson's Disease program to help bring creative movement to a community that is traditionally considered inelegant. We empower participants to explore movement in ways that are refreshing and creative. My teaching emphasized dance rather than therapy in order to foster creativity in the Parkinson's community at a time when others assume dance is a lost cause. I am not elite. I am purposeful. I carry that purpose with me as an assistant professor at Oakland University. I carry that purpose with me as I travel the world performing with my fellow dancers and Take Root, the dance company I co-founded. Elbrooks Patterson has inspired me to be involved in Oakland County, our county. I want my four-year-old twins to see the work I do and recognize its importance, relevance, and impact on those in need in our community. Through all of the classes comes the realization that dance offers more than just movement. These classes generate joy, creativity, community support, laughter, and freedom. I am thrilled to be working with the Elite 40 Under 40 class of 2016 and Brooks's administration to continue this path of paying it forward. It is my honor to introduce Chief Executive Officer of Oakland County, Elbrooks Patterson.
Thanks.
Honey. I got you.
Oops. Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, I don't know who, man. I don't know who wrote the intro in that film that you saw the video of Allie, but they left off one of the most important attributes of her career. For 6 years, she was a Rockette. How about that, eh? That had nothing to do with my vote on the Elite 40. First of all, thank you, Allie, for becoming our winner here in the Elite 40 Under 40 class of 2016. That was a very generous introduction. I appreciate it. Thank you. This is the fifth class of our Elite 40 Under 40. This unique program singles out 40 of the best and brightest young business types and entrepreneurs here in Oakland County, those who we figure will be the leaders of the county tomorrow. From working with these classes now for 5 years, I'm convinced that the future of Oakland County, and for that matter, the country, is in good hands. Would the members of the Elite 40 Under 40 class of 2016, and for that matter, any other members from previous classes, please stand to be recognized by the audience. Please stand up. Thank you. Thank you. I told this group earlier that I'm going to start an 80 under 80 so I can have my own recognition. Well, welcome to all of you to the 2016 State of the County Address. Well, the question is, how are we doing? To put it bluntly, the state of Oakland County is strong, amazingly strong, vibrant. And why am I so pleased and confident? Well, let me count the ways. Oakland County has roared back from the devastating days of the Great Recession to reach a goal that the economists call full employment. And that's due to our economic diversification into the knowledge-based economy. Oakland County, the business investment, just in the first 6 months of last year, was more than $750 million, surpassing the total business investment for all of 2014 by nearly $100 million. Our economic prowess has gained us worldwide attention. Last year, foreign companies invested $352 million directly into Oakland County. That's more than some states enjoy. The Center for Digital Government continues to rank Oakland County among the most digitally advanced counties in America. That's for 11 years running. Our multi-year budget is balanced through 2021. That's 5 years from now. That bears repeating. Our budget is balanced through 2021. I feel like Jeb Bush. You can applaud now. Our bond rating remains AAA, a distinction that we've held since 1998. Just this week, Moody's Investor Services and Standard & Poor's reaffirmed our AAA bond rating. S&P indicated that Oakland County can outperform, listen to this, we can outperform the United States government under fiscal stress. S&P said that the AAA bond rating is supported by Oakland County, so I'm going to quote them, quote, strong economy, very strong management, very strong budgetary flexibility with a high available fund balance, end quote. Now here's a takeaway from my address tonight. Oakland County is the best managed county in the United States. Now, that's not me saying that. That comment came from Moody's Investor Services, one of the nation's most respected bond rating agencies. Our excellence in budgeting and our embracing of the knowledge-based economy has placed us in a national leadership role. As you write your state of the county address, you always hope that there is one major announcement that can be included to sort of set the tone. Well, I have such an announcement tonight. It's something that I've been working on with the director of Michigan Department of Transportation, Kirk Steitel, for at least 5 years. It is something that is long overdue and should be celebrated by all the motorists in Southeast Michigan who use I-75, especially those commuters who drive Michigan's busiest expressway at rush hour. Oakland County has reached an agreement with the Michigan Department of Transportation, that's MDOT, to modernize I-75 by adding a fourth lane starting at 8 Mile Road all the way up to M-59. Yeah. And then three lanes from M-59 up to the Genesee County line. Now, if you would examine a map and check everything within 6 miles of I-75, that would be 3 miles on the west and 3 miles on the east. Along that stretch of I-75, you would find over 23,000 businesses located there, more than half of the businesses in Oakland County, and they employ nearly 339,000 individuals. That's about half of our workforce. Let's face it, I-75 is Oakland County's main street. It carries more cars than any other expressway in Michigan, 120,000 cars a day. Adding a fourth lane on the north and southbound I-75 from 8 Mile to M-59 will have a significant impact on commerce and driver convenience. Companies along I-75, like Fiat Chrysler, support I-75's modernization. They will see their employees in a safer commute. It will give companies along I-75 the ability to move goods more quickly through that corridor, and certainly improve the quality of life by easing some of the worst congestion we have in our area. Now, I've come up with a story that underscores the extent of the problem congestion on I-75. I cite a report from the Traffic Improvement Association that after examining Oakland County's roads and the number of deaths per vehicular mile traveled, Oakland County's roads, and I'm not making this up, Oakland County's roads are the safest roads in Michigan. They are the safest roads in the United States. In fact, they are the safest roads in North America, South America, and Europe. Per 100 million vehicular miles driven in Oakland County, we have a death rate of 0.04%. That's better than any other political jurisdiction in the world. 0.04% per 100 million miles of vehicular traffic. Just let that sink in. Of course, I'm quick to point out to MDOT and to our road commission that the reason that our rate is so low is because the average rate of speed you can attain in I-75 is 4 miles an hour. Now, who the hell can get killed in a 4 mile an hour impact? But the story does make my point. I-75, the busiest expressway in Michigan, becomes a parking lot at rush hour. We need relief, and we're going to get it. And I'm delighted that MDOT, under the leadership of Kirk Steitel, has green-lighted this project. Thank you, Mr. Steitel. I created the Elite 40 program as a way to tap into the enthusiasm and know-how of the younger generation, because they are going to be the future leaders of Oakland County. Indeed, current studies indicate that younger adults are making up a greater percentage of the workforce. For example, the millennials are outnumbering the baby boomers, the former making up 34% of the workforce in Oakland County. And what does that mean for our county? Well, we realize to remain competitive in the knowledge-based economy, we need to attract younger workers with new ideas, a brain gain instead of a brain drain. That's why we announced back in December that we would be adding a fifth committee to the Oakland County Business Roundtable. This committee will be made up of members who are younger than 40. This will be a key way for my administration to stay informed and initiate policies that will attract younger adults to the Oakland County as a great place to live, work, and raise a family. Now, I launched the Business Roundtable back in 1993 as a way for the business community to have input into programs that make Oakland County favorable for job growth. Until now, we had four committees focusing on economic development, transportation, workforce and education, and quality of life. My administration has implemented over 80% of the recommendations coming from these committees. That is why we are looking forward to the new committee focusing on the younger than 40 crowd to hear what their ideas are and to turn those ideas into actions as well. Human capital is our most important resource in any organization. To be the best county government, we need to continue to recruit the bright, innovative minds. When today's millennials graduate from college or technical school, trade school, or voc ed, they have workplace expectations, some of which our current county benefit programs have not been able to meet. As a result, their first thoughts upon graduation is often careers that don't even look at Oakland County. And we need to change all that. I want them to give Oakland County government a little closer look. To do that, we need to compete with what they see in the private sector. We need to show our future employees a career path that creates a fair balance between work and family, something that the new workforce seeks. That's why I'm excited to make the following announcement today. I will propose that Oakland County move forward with a program that offers paid parental leave for both mothers and fathers. The final design of this plan will be determined in partnership with the Board of Commissioners. The goal will be to provide 6 weeks of paid leave for both parents. The birth mother's leave will be in addition to any other maternity disability benefits they currently provide. Paid parental leave is a benefit current and future employees look for. It is a benefit for the new parent that provide a real advantage to families. A paid parental leave for both parents, is that an off-the-wall idea for government? No. It's all about recruiting talented employees. We must compete with those in the private sector. Google, Amazon, Facebook, Netflix are just a few of the major U.S. corporations that offer paid parental leave for both mom and dad. And what do these companies have in common? They're among the companies attracting younger generation with new workforce expectations. I think with age, I've turned into a damn liberal, I don't know. with the foresight and planning of Kathy Forsley, who heads up the county's health division, she has developed a game changer for public health in Oakland County and Michigan. Back in 2014, Kathy and George Miller, my director of Health and Human Services, launched an initiative called ECHO, which stands for Energizing Connections for Healthier Oakland. Over the past year, Oakland County and its public health partners have conducted a comprehensive countywide assessment of residents and businesses to get the big picture of health practices in the county and the health status of our residents. It is the first time that such a survey has been done on this scale in Michigan. We looked at 11 core categories, which included health resource availability, behavioral risk factors, maternal and child health, environmental health, those are just a few. We have analyzed the data, and here are some of our highlights, some of the findings. 10% of the middle school children and 11.4% of high school kids are obese. We are performing better than the National Healthy People 2020 benchmark for the United States, which has 14.5% obesity reported for that age group. We'd like to improve our numbers under the ECHO program. One in five Oakland County adults reported eating fruits and vegetables daily. That's better than the 16% of adults statewide, but far below the national benchmark of 32%. We will utilize this data to reshape the focus of our health programs and policies in a way that will have the greatest impact on improving the overall health of our residents and thereby moving the quality of life and improving the quality of life in this county. In June, my administration and 32 health partners in this effort will announce a community health improvement plan based on the ECHO survey. We will ask Oakland County businesses and organizations to align their wellness strategies with ECHO. If we are able to get the buy-in we are seeking from Oakland County companies, we will, as I said a moment ago, move the needle on the public health forward in Oakland County. This will be a model program not only for the rest of Michigan, but for counties across the United States. None of it would have been possible without our 32 partner organizations, which are listed on the screens behind me, many of whom have the representatives here tonight. I want to thank you all for coming. As I'm sure you can tell by now, Oakland County is a collaborator. The ECHO program is just one of many examples where we have accomplished what we have in bringing together public and private organizations to use their combined expertise to address an issue. We've done it in our homeless healthcare collaboration to deal with the chronic health issues of homeless individuals on a clinical rather than an emergency room level, saving hospitals and taxpayers millions of dollars with the help of dozens of partner agencies. Our Healthy Pontiac We Can Coalition is helping Pontiac residents have greater access to healthy food and exercise with the support of numerous public health and private partners. And our Healthy Oakland Partnership, which is a collaboration of local governments, hospitals, healthcare providers, community-based organizations, businesses, and residents, is dedicated to improving the health of all of Oakland County residents. But here's another group out there that needs our help. Oakland County is home to 72,000 veterans. Whether they served in peacetime or war, our veterans made many sacrifices and were willing to risk life and limb to defend our freedoms. My Veterans Services Division, which is led by Public Services Director Mark Newman and Manager Garth Wooten, stand ready to help. Oakland County Veterans Services Division is only in one state that our Oakland County Health Veterans Division is the only one in the state that has two full-time offices. Open to veterans without appointment, each office is staffed by veterans benefits counselors who are accredited by the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs. In 2015, Veterans Services Division, listen to this, completed over 5,600 applications for veterans benefits and over 8,400 other benefit-related forms. But our Veterans Services Division does much more than fight to get veterans the most out of their military service benefits. They collaborate with a number of organizations, both public and private, on projects such as Veterans Resource Fair in Pontiac in July, which dealt with the VA, medical, disability, pension, and burial benefits, employment, and vocation rehabilitation, to name but a few. And for the second year in a row, our Veterans Services Division is collaborating with partnering agencies to address the issue of veterans homelessness. In last year's State of the County, I reported that they had found housing for 68 homeless veterans. So far this year, the partners have housed an additional 92 veterans in suitable housing. That's a total of 160. We provide direct support to our four veterans treatment courts because they're located here in the county. We've even launched an Oakland County Veterans Community Action Team with the goal to assist veterans with whatever support they might need. Truly, I could go on. But I think you're getting the idea that not only does Oakland County value its veterans, but we have put in place the resources necessary to assist each and every one of them. This next section is interesting. Not that it hasn't been interesting before, but as Oakland County Executive, one of my duties to residents, guests, and businesses in this county is to oversee homeland security. Because of that responsibility, recent events involving active shooters over the past several months weigh heavy on my mind. I know that, God forbid, if an active shooter ever comes to Oakland County, whether as an act of terrorism or that of an unstable person, that it will be Oakland County Sheriff's deputies and other local first responders who will be mobilized. Our County Emergency Operations Center will be up and running immediately to provide support for those in the field. Over 3 years ago, I directed the Homeland Security Division under the leadership of George Miller, Homeland Security Manager Ted Quisenberry, and Chief Sarah Stoddard to begin offering active shooter training in partnership with the Oakland County Sheriff's Department. Active shooter training does not prevent an active shooter from attacking people. What it does is offer those in the line of fire a fighting chance and to teach them how to assess the threat and determine whether they should run, hide, or fight. First, we offered active shooter training to teachers and school administrators, then to doctors, nurses, and staff at hospitals and shopping center employees. Just last week, dozens of personnel from Southeast Michigan colleges and universities, a total of 60 institutions, took part in our active shooter training program. This year, we will expand that training to long-term care facilities where perhaps some of your loved ones are housed. George, Ted, and Sarah, please stand up and be recognized for an important job well done. Speaking of looking ahead and being prepared, let's talk about a public health concern that is currently making headlines, the Zika virus. The Center for Disease Control indicates that from January to February 3rd, there were 35 travel-related Zika virus cases in the U.S., here in the United States. Earlier this month, I directed Oakland County Health Division to prepare to respond should the mosquito that carries the Zika virus arrive here in Michigan. Here's what Oakland County Health Division has accomplished so far. Oakland County's webpage has information on the Zika virus travel advisory. The county's Hospital Partnership Committee participated in a presentation last week on what is known at this point about the Zika virus, the mosquito that carries it, testing protocol for pregnant women who visited any one of the countries you see on the screen, and the EPA-approved repellents. This presentation was sent to our emergency preparedness public health partners as well, and the Health Division online physician portal also contains information on this topic for any physician signed up to our health portal. All Oakland County obstetricians and gynecologists will receive this information through fax and email this week. Our Health Division Nurse on Call, Environmental Health Unit, as well as our Epidemiology Unit, are currently tracking the number of phone calls that we receive each day and will be reporting those numbers to the Health Administration. Our Environmental Health Unit attended a Michigan Mosquito Abatement Conference in Ann Arbor last week, where the Zika virus was a topic of conversation. In early March, the Health Division will hold its annual meeting with our partners in cities, villages, and townships to update them on this large, with the latest news about the Zika virus. In addition, I'm not waiting for the Zika virus to be identified in Michigan. Proactively, Oakland County will utilize a portion of its West Nile virus budget to also combat the Zika virus. These funds are allocated to the cities, villages, and townships for education, such as controlling and avoiding mosquitoes, cleaning out catch basins so mosquitoes can't reproduce, killing mosquito larvae in catch basins, and providing individual mosquito repellent to large community outdoor events. I'm pleased to announce tonight that we are bolstering our mosquito response budget by $160,000, bringing it up to a total of $350,000. Okay. Oakland County is and will be ready. So far, let's shift our talk about a regional success story, and it'll be the Great Lakes Water Authority. In the audience tonight are my regional counterparts. The media likes to dub us the Big Four. Please give a welcoming round of applause to Wayne County Executive Warren Evans. Warren, where are you seated? And Macomb County Executive Mark Hackle. Mark. And the Mayor of Detroit, Mike Duggan. Michael. The Great Lakes Water Authority, or GLEWA, as we call it around our office, began to operate officially just a little over a month ago, on January 1st. There were a lot of hurdles to clear to get to that point. There were 10 conditions precedent that had to be met in order for the lease to be valid. To be honest with you, over the summer, we were unsure whether these conditions could be or would be met. But thanks to the strong leadership of my Deputy Executive Bob Dado, Chief Deputy Executive Jerry Poisson, and my regional counterparts I just introduced to you all, the GLEWA and the Detroit Water and Sewer Board met those conditions. So what does this mean for the Oakland County ratepayer and for ratepayers you all represent? It means for the first time that the Oakland County ratepayer has a real seat at the table and when it comes to running the water system. It means to make a major decision, the GLEWA board requires a supermajority vote, that's 5 out of 6 members. It means to block anything detrimental to Oakland County ratepayers, we need only find one other suburban official to stand with us in the boardroom. I can tell you it also puts an end to the crony contracts, the kind of friends and family deals that sent those under Kwame Kilpatrick's water department to prison. Indeed, contracts. Indeed, contracts will be bid out to the lowest qualified bidder. There will be transparency in the process. And with my deputy, Bob Dado, beginning his second one-year term as chairperson of GLEWA, he will ensure that the same transparent purchasing policies we have here in Oakland County will become the standard at GLEWA. We believe that transparent open bidding will lower GLEWA's costs over the long term. A hallmark of my administration has been, I think, our excellence in budgeting. In case you didn't catch it before, the county's budget is balanced through the year 2021. I'll repeat that over and over. When we saw the perfect storm of the Great Recession on the horizon in the early 2000s, thanks to our multi-year budgeting practices, we were able to reorganize and reduce county government between the years 2008 and 2011. That enabled us to absorb the greatest percentage loss in property value of any county in Michigan. We reduced the budget more than $50 million while minimally impacting services to our customers and laying off no employees. From 2012 to 2015, we transitioned into maintaining and stabilizing our budget. Our thoughtful management versus crisis management approach helped us weather the storm of the Great Recession. And when the skies began to clear, things were improving on the horizon. I did something very smart back in the early 2000s. I know, beginner's luck. I formed what we call the Budget Task Force. I took my senior deputies, that would be Chief Deputy County Executive Jerry Poisson, Deputy County Executives Bob Dado, Phil Bertolini, Malcolm Brown, and Matt Gibb, Director of Management and Budget, Lori Van Pelt, and the Director of Human Resources, Jordy Kramer. I asked him to serve on this new but very important committee assignment within my administration. The Budget Task Force has met weekly starting back in 2002 to make sure that we're on track to meet our budget goals. Because of diligence and the hard work of the Budget Task Force, Oakland County made it through the budgetary challenges that spiked in 2010. Just because the Great Recession is finally over and we are on our way back, it made no sense to me to disband the Budget Task Force. So they continue to meet today and scan the horizon for any problems. Of course, we wouldn't have been able to balance our budget without the cooperation of the Board of Commissioners and the other countywide elected officials and judges who all took some hits. I'd like to take a moment to thank Board Chairman Mike Gengel, Vice Chairman Mike Spees, Oakland County Sheriff Mike Bouchard, Oakland County Clerk Register of Deeds Lisa Brown, Oakland County Prosecutor Jessica Cooper, Oakland County Treasurer Andy Meisner, Chief Circuit Court Judge Nancy Grant, Chief Probate Judge Elizabeth Pizzetti, and Chief District Court Judge Julie Nicholson. Together, we Republicans and Democrats rose above politics to put the interests of the residents and the taxpayers first and to shepherd this county through one of its most difficult periods. Beginning this year and beyond, we are investing for sustainability in our employees and programs. When over a third of our workforce is now eligible to retire, we want to attract and retain top talent to serve the public in the various ways that the county government does. At the low point in the Great Recession, we rolled back salaries of our county employees 4%, and all salaries were frozen between 2012 and 2013. Now we've begun to return employee salaries to pre-recession levels. Though county salaries still lag behind the private sector, we're becoming more competitive. Because we have transitioned employees from defined benefit plans, such as pensions and healthcare, retiree healthcare, to defined contribution plans, such as 401k style retirement accounts and retirement health savings accounts, we have saved taxpayers hundreds of millions of dollars. We also are able to bolster the benefits that will attract and retain great employees, such as increasing tuition reimbursement for the first time. We want our employees to stick around for a long time, and their institutional knowledge helps the county to serve residents and others as well as it does. We're also investing in our government campus through the Facilities Management Department, headed up by Director Art Holdsworth and managers Ed Joss and Joe Murphy. For instance, at the Children's Village, where Director of Health and Human Services George Miller, Manager Jody Overall, and their staff care for some of the Oakland County's most vulnerable children, and we have collaborated with the Oakland County Oakland Integrated Healthcare Network to open a medical clinic on site, staffed by doctors and nurses Monday through Friday from 9 to 5. It is the only juvenile care center in Michigan now that provides a full-time medical clinic for kids. The doctors in this clinic will provide preventive medical care, including physicals for the children, instead of merely being on call for emergencies. We will, be building a new animal control and pet adoption center on our main government campus in Pontiac, slated to open in 2017. I got the picture? I think I'll move in that, please. Now that we are investing for sustainability, we plan to build a facility that enhances the care we give to the nearly 5,000 animals that come through those doors every year and optimize the likelihood of adopting them out. Animal Control Division, overseen by my Director of Public Services, Mark Newman, and Manager Bob Gapp, want to adopt out as many of these pets as possible. We believe that locating the building on our main government campus instead of out on its current site in Auburn Hills will be a more central and easier to find location that will encourage more people to visit the Pet Adoption Center. At the helm of our Department of Information Technology are my Deputy County Executive and CIO, Phil Berlini, and Director Ed Poisson, Chief Technology Officer Jim Taylor, and Chief Information Security Officer Chris Burrows. As part of the county's investing for sustainability, they will install a new unified communications and wireless system to replace our aging phone and messaging system. This new system should improve our employees' ability to communicate internally with each other and externally with the public. The new system looks to address the need to communicate and do business with a more technically savvy public. IT is a commitment to a leading-edge technology that makes it easier for employees to do their job and provide better service to our customers is one of the main reasons that the Center for Digital Government continues to rank Oakland County among the most digitally advanced counties in the United States for 11 years now. All this is possible because of Oakland County's fiscal conservatism and budgetary excellence. As the county continues its robust recovery, there is one sure sign that our economic engine is revving up. It's what economists call full employment, where the unemployment rate drops to or below 5%. At one point during the Great Recession, Oakland County led the state in unemployment at 15%. With the hard work and dedication of our employees and the discipline of our budget task force and the excellence of our job creating programs, Oakland County reached the distinction of full employment in 2015. Currently, our county unemployment rate stands at 4.2%, which is better than the U.S. average. Those were some really tough years from 2000 to 2009. Under lackluster leadership in Lansing, Michigan lost 806,000 jobs, or a 17.2% reduction in the workforce, according to the Mackinac Center for Public Policy. Oakland County felt the sting of those years. From 2000 to 2010, Oakland County lost more than 163,000 jobs, nearly 60,000 of which were from the auto industry implosion in 2009. Fortunately, we had the foresight to begin in the late 1990s to start a diversification of our economy program with the deep dive into the knowledge-based economy. In 1999, we launched Automation Alley, which now stands on its own, separate from Oakland County, as a regional driver of high-tech job attraction. It is now the largest high-tech business consortium in the Midwest. In 2004, we created the highly successful Emerging Sectors program to tap into the 10 sectors of the economy that would provide sustainable high-paying jobs for decades to come. In IT's flagship of our successful foray into the knowledge-based economy, of course, was the accumulation of those in development of those 10 sectors. In 2008, we had an aha moment when we realized that healthcare was our largest economic sector, accounting for about one in every 5.5 jobs. So we built on that economic strength to further advance our diversification with the launch of Medical Main Street. Why not highlight it? You have it. Within the last couple of years, we decided to harness the power of our fastest growing and second largest sector, information technology, utilizing our new Tech 248 initiative. Oakland County has more than 2,000 IT companies and growing. That number represents half of all the IT companies in Southeast Michigan. Those deep dives into the knowledge-based economy under the leadership of Deputy County Executive Matt Gibb and Director of Economic Development Irene Spanos and Deputy Director Dan Hunter are paying huge dividends. We're gaining back the jobs from the lost decade of the 2000 at a pace quicker than experts anticipated. In the first 4 years of our recovery from the Great Recession, we've gained back over 79,000 jobs, most of which are in the medium to high wage category. University of Michigan economist Dr. George Fulton and Donna Grimes conservatively forecast that we will add an additional 49,000 jobs through the end of 2017. I mean, I think we'll beat that number. That means by the end of next year, we will have recovered at least 78% of the jobs lost in the first decade of this new millennium. And make no mistake, Fulton and Grimes specifically point to our Emerging Sectors program as one of the leading reasons for the speed up of our recovery. While I'm speaking of emerging sectors, let me update you on our emerging sectors numbers. By the end of 2015, emerging sectors had seen 371 successful business attractions with total investment of more than $3.3 billion, creating 37,000 jobs and retaining 21,000. That's 58,000 jobs. We celebrated reaching that $3 billion investment mark with a big party in the hangar of Pentastar Aviation at Oakland County International Airport last fall. It was our way to say thank you to the emerging sector companies for having the confidence to invest in Oakland County. More than 700 executives and employees of emerging sector companies attended the event. I'd like to give a shout out to Edsel Ford and Pentastar Aviation for being our gracious hosts that evening. I tell my people in many speeches that by diversifying our economy into these 10 categories from within the knowledge-based economy, that won't necessarily make Oakland County recession-proof. But I do argue that it will make Oakland County recession-resistant. And I think that's about the most I can hope for. There are a couple of other numbers worth celebrating tonight, and that comes from the Oakland County Economic Development Corporation and the Oakland County Business Finance Corporation, which have been serving our small business community for 35 years. 3.5 decades, and they've helped finance 648 businesses for a total investment of $1.5 billion in creating over 26,500 jobs. I just love hearing numbers that begin with the word B. You can see, folks, we are really running on all cylinders. But we're not just about the knowledge-based economy in Oakland County. Since the launch of my emerging sectors in 2004, we've also continued to be aggressive about attracting what we call traditional companies, meaning they're not under the umbrella of the emerging sectors. In 2015, we had 5 traditional companies move their headquarters to Oakland County. These are names that I'm sure most of you will recognize. Daimler Financial Services, the financial arm of the German automaker, consolidated its North American headquarters in Farmington Hills. TI Automotive, which develops, manufactures, and supplies automotive fluid storage and carrying delivery systems, is locating its North American headquarters in Auburn Hills. Superior Industries, the largest manufacturer of aluminum wheels in North America, chose Southfield for its site for its North American headquarters. Next Tier Automotive, which manufactures advanced steering and driveline systems, planted its North American flag in Troy. And Aramco, the Saudi Arabian National Petroleum and Natural Gas Company, opened its research headquarters in Novi. Our success at continuing to attract traditional companies is like so many other things we do, evident by the numbers. In 2004, the year we launched our Emerging Sectors Initiative, we have parallel investment from the traditional companies of 243 traditional successes for a total of $2.3 billion, creating 13,700 jobs and retaining 19,400 others. That's a total of 33,100. Now, back in 2000, my administration launched a first-of-its-kind initiative that has put thousands of individuals to work, as well as enhancing the quality of life, making Oakland County one of the premier shopping, dining, and entertainment destinations in Southeast Michigan. I, of course, am speaking of Main Street Oakland County, the first countywide Main Street program in America. With 32 actual downtowns in Oakland County, we launched Main Street Oakland County to create a unique sense of place in each community with an eye on historic preservation. Today, 22 communities such as Ferndale and Birmingham and Rochester and Holly are participating in the Main Street Oakland County program at some level. With 2015 marking our 15th year, an update is in order. Since inception, Main Street Oakland County has seen 940 businesses invest $668 million, creating 7,000 jobs. Now let's add up these numbers. We had $3.3 billion in the Emerging Sectors Program, $1.5 billion from the Business Finance Corporation, $2.3 billion in the traditional successes, $668 million from the Main Street Oakland County effort. We're talking about a total investment in Oakland County of about $7.8 billion derived directly from these programs. The thing to keep in mind about those figures is that they are probably lower than the actual total investment in Oakland County. There are hundreds of businesses that over the years that have landed here in Oakland County without any county involvement. We have no idea what that investment total would be from those companies, but I think it's safe to say it would be in the billions. So I opened my speech tonight by telling you that the state of Oakland County is strong, amazingly strong and vibrant. I think the numbers tell the whole story. The success of reaching full employment brings with it a unique challenge of continuing to attract top-level companies that want to expand or relocate here. Once a county reaches full employment, as we have, those left unemployed tend to be the structurally unemployed. As always, Oakland County, I think, is up to the challenge. Our Workforce Development Division, led by manager John Olmsted, who I hate to announce tonight, is retiring at the end of this month after 37 years with the county. You'll be missed, John. It is he who is leveraging the Community Ventures Program through Michigan Works to address putting the structurally unemployed back into the talent pool. Community Ventures, he looks at each individual's barriers to employment to identify what kind of training or assistance they need to get back into the work pool. It helps provide mentoring opportunities as well. And it even helps structurally unemployed individuals develop an employment history. The Workforce Development Division is also utilizing Michigan Skilled Trades Funds to improve the work expectation of employees of dozens of other sites around the county, such as Beaumont Health, Magna International, Burroughs, and Fiat Chrysler, to name a few. We also have efforts aimed at reversing the so-called brain drain. We are reaching out to students as young as high school age to show them that by staying in Oakland County, that they can work with leading-edge technology. We sponsored Manufacturing Day last year, where 720 Oakland County high school students toured 28 advanced manufacturing facilities to see that modern manufacturing is not their grandfather's manufacturing. Our manufacturers use robots, software, and other advanced technologies that require technically skilled employees. The message to our youth that day, you don't have to move to Silicon Valley to work with advanced technology. It's right here in Oakland County. 2 years ago, I pointed to the moon and said, let's go there. At least that's what I'm told. I wasn't talking about a lunar mission. I was talking about something that would require imagination, feats of engineering, and a lot of collaboration between the public and private sectors. I'm talking about connected vehicles. You hear so much about that today. Back in my 2014 State of the County speech, I announced that I wanted Oakland County to be the first in the world to have a countywide connected vehicle infrastructure system. We're well on our way, believe it or not. I began by appointing an industry expert to a panel that we call the Oakland County Connected Vehicle Task Force. Much of the global research in connected and autonomous vehicles is already happening right here in Oakland County. And through our task force, the county hopes to position itself as one of the leaders in converting research into reality. The primary goal of the task force is to create a feasible business model for implementing connected vehicle infrastructure so the private sector has something to invest in. The task force, chaired by Fred Nieder, quickly moved ahead and gained headway in 2014. Just 7 months after my announcement, the task force demonstrated that cars using current technology could communicate with the infrastructure around it. And looking ahead to 2016, we have an opportunity to accelerate and advance connected vehicle research in Oakland County. As I said a moment ago, MDOT is going forward with an expansion of I-75 in Oakland County. This represents a tremendous opportunity for advancing connected vehicle infrastructure in our county. MDOT Director Kirk Steidel is researching the feasibility of making I-75 a connected freeway through Oakland County. From the point of view of Oakland County Connected Vehicle Task Force, we are excited about the possibilities if I-75 were to become a connected freeway through our county. We know the auto companies and their suppliers would utilize it as a test bed to advance their connected vehicle research. And it would be happening right here in the heart of Oakland County, Southeast Michigan. In September, got my granddaughter, row one here. And I'm not sure she knows what I'm talking about, but it's her grandpa. In September, Oakland County achieved another first in Michigan transportation. Oakland County International Airport hosted the state's first air transportation expo with our friends from the Michigan Business Aviation Association, or MBAA. Business aviation tends to suffer quite a bit in an economic downturn. It tends to be the first one to go into recession and the last one out. As robust as our recovery has been, it hasn't been so for general aviation. The task at the expo was to educate corporate decision makers about Oakland County's international airport and its modern facilities, the aviation businesses that surround the airport, and what utilizing them means for the corporation's bottom line. Indeed, if you are a company which frequently sends out four or more employees on a business trip together, you'll be able to save money by chartering a flight rather than using commercial airlines. Plus, what is your employee's time worth? Would you rather have them spend 2 hours clearing TSA and waiting to board a plane, or leave right away and return home that evening? From the Oakland County International Airport, you can take off with a full load of fuel and reach every major market in the world. That wasn't always that way a few years ago. Only when the highway was moved, we advanced the runway. Planes couldn't take off with a full load. They couldn't get up ahead of steam. So if you flew to LA, you'd have to refuel in Denver or someplace along the way. Well, today, planes can take off with a full load of fuel, and you can reach any market in the world. Okay. You can reach 10 times as many airports in the U.S. as the commercial airlines do. You can opt for a business model that fits your corporate goals, whether it's an aircraft charter or a fractional ownership, which is basically is like a timeshare for planes. Well, the Michigan First Air Transportation Expo was a resounding success. We invited Dassault, Falcon, Bombardier, Gulfstream, and Textron Aviation to display corporate aircraft. The feedback from them was phenomenal. Just weeks earlier, they had been and attended a similar event in Missouri. The aircraft manufacturers were disappointed with the organization and the clientele in Missouri. When they came to Oakland County, they said, "Vive la difference," and they were pleased with what they saw. Our Air Transportation Expo was well received because we put the right corporate decision makers with the manufacturers and our airport businesses. Our expo visitors were so delighted with the outcome of our Air Transportation Expo, they asked us to do another one in 2016, this year. I'm pleased to announce tonight that we will host Oakland County's second Air Transportation Expo on September 22nd. If you are interested, and you're in the room here, in attending the next one, visit the airport's display table in the hallway, or just call the airport offices and they will register you. The expo was a success because of the remarkable collaboration between public and private sectors once again. I'd like to thank my Director of Central Services, Dave Vanderveen, Airport Manager, Carl Randall, Airport Administration Supervisor, Pat Scholl, the MBAA, the Michigan Department of Transportation, Pentastar Aviation, Corporate Eagle, and dozens of exhibitors who came together to make the expo a success. Individual employees, in some cases full divisions, receive awards and recognitions throughout the year. They are far too numerous to mention tonight, so I'll run their names on the screens behind me as I speak. However, I would like to highlight a few employees who have obtained exceptional results for the county and are singled out tonight for some well-deserved recognition. The first awardee I would like to mention is Julie Secantine, my risk manager for Oakland County. But she's much more than that. She has had a statewide impact for her contributions to the fire service here in Michigan. Julie has helped implement the Mutual Aid Box Alarm System, or MABUS, in Michigan. MABUS is designed to strengthen the requesting and providing of fire service and emergency resources across Michigan for day-to-day mutual aid and for large-scale events such as fires, train derailments, tornadoes, and such. The Michigan Association Fire Chiefs President, Michael O'Brien, made the following comment, and I'll quote, "Julie has done more work to help the fire service in Michigan to be prepared than any other civilian in recent history. Her work with development and continual support of Task Force One to MABUS has been exemplary," end of quote. It is no wonder then that Julie was drafted from my office to take a position as the fire marshal for the state of Michigan. She will be leaving Oakland County and transferring her many talents to her new position in Lansing, and we wish her well. As Julie. As Julie departs, I'm delighted to report that I have appointed Dean Schultz as her successor. Dean, Dean, a 27-year county employee, is currently serving as the safety coordinator in the risk management department. While I'm making announcements tonight of promotions, I certainly don't want to overlook the recent promotion of Jordy Kramer, who last year took over the role of Director of Human Services, one of the major departments in county government, and I might add, doing an outstanding job. Information technology continues to garner national recognition through the leadership of Deputy County Executive and CIO Phil Bertolini and Director Ed Poisson. Their leadership has earned us, among other things, recognition as the most digitally advanced county in America. We captured the 2015 Optimus Award for Innovation for making leading-edge human resource software available to other governments in the cloud. And next, I'd like to announce that the Michigan State Housing Development Authority named Lon Shook, a senior community and home improvement specialist from Oakland County, as the 2015 Housing Program Council of the Year. You know, Lon and his co-workers in the Community and Home Improvement Division, with Carrie Reith as the manager, truly do exceptional work. For more than 40 years, Community and Home Improvement, or CHI, has helped low-income residents with their housing needs and supported numerous community development projects through the administration of grants. One number that impresses me is how many families facing foreclosure that they were able to keep in their homes. In 2015, coming out of the recession, a bad year, this department had amazing results. The percent of successes, 98%. Let me repeat that. 98% of the families that came to my CHI counselors, like Lon Shook, were able to stay in their homes. Folks, did get much better now. Another award for a very important program is our wellness program. We call it Oak Fit. I launched it back in 2007 to help manage the county's rising healthcare costs. Since its inception, it has reined in cost increases and helped the county save more than $24 million in healthcare costs. In 2015, Corp Magazine honored Oak Fit It is one of the biggest, is the best and brightest in wellness, and the Governor's Council on Physical Fitness and Health and Sports spotlighted OakFit for a second year in a row, according to the Diamond Level Healthy Workplace Award. As I was composing my speech for tonight, I realized what a terrible date I had selected, February 10th. It's been 42 months to the day since my accident, August 12, 2012. But worse, an even worse anniversary on this date is 9 years ago, I lost my son, Brooksy. And Kathy's here, we lost our son. I asked my media and communications officer, Bill Mullen, was he the one who selected this date? He said, that was me, boss. And trying to respond in a very fair way, I said, how long have you worked for the county, but don't include today? Well, we're a couple of minutes away from my close of my 2016 State of the County, and you've heard my report. I hope that when you leave tonight, you are buoyed with the confidence that Oakland County is doing very, very well. With a budget balance through 2021, an economic diversification program that has helped us reach full employment, you can tell why I am proud of what we've accomplished and enthusiastic about the direction in which we are headed. I'm asked from time to time when I might retire. And I tell those people that I'll know it's time when I wake up on a Monday morning and I don't look forward to going to work, but I'll know it's time to say farewell. Well, I've never had a Monday morning like that, or for that matter, any other morning. I love my job. I go to work every day committed to managing the best county in the United States of America. With all due respect, fellows. Well, there's still some work to be done, some mountains to climb and some dragons to slay. That is why I am confirming tonight that I will seek re-election this year for my 7th term. Obviously, running for my 7th term, I still can't take anything for granted. So I ask for your help tonight. Please spread the good word about what's going on in Oakland County, and be sure to vote on Tuesday, November the 8th, and tell all your Democrat friends that the election has been moved to Wednesday, November the 9th. Thank you for your continued support. Ladies and gentlemen, now please join me across the hall for an afterglow. Thank you.